नमस्कार, मैं हूं प्रियाशा पाठक और रोजहब की गपशप सीरीज सीजन 2 के एपिसोड 1 में आप सबका स्वागत है। आज हमारे साथ हैं दीपक गधिया सर, तो आइए जानते हैं उन्हीं से उनके जीवन के एक्सपीरियंसेस और उनकी जर्नी के बारे में। सर, आप सबसे पहले हमें ये बताइए कि आपके बचपन से कैसे आपने स्टार्ट किया, आपकी स्कूलिंग कैसी हुई, आपके घर में पेरेंट्स कैसा था सब कुछ?
I apologize, but I will answer in English.
No problem.
I was born and brought up in Bombay. I was very fortunate that I was born to well-to-do parents. And like all youngsters, when I was young, I was more in canteen than in classroom. Because I thought that because I'm born to rich parents, my money is going to work for me and I can hire the best brain, best people. But fortunately, by the time I finished my studies, my father told me that you're not going to inherit the business, you will have to earn it. And for that, you have to prove yourself. So go out, work, get experience. And then if I think you are good enough to take this chair, you'll get it. And it was then that I realized that I had neglected the most important thing in my life, that was studies. And that's something which you cannot ever really make up for. You can, of course, learn a lot. But those good moments which were there, I missed. Anyway, as they say, there is always another chance. So when I started going out in the market, I very quickly realized that I had done my Bachelor's of Science in Bombay. So while I was studying in college, to impress the girls, I used to always say, you know, I'm going to go to USA because I have an uncle in USA. And I always thought that, the pasture is always greener on the other side. So I always say America is the West, West is the best. And I always found India to be very dirty, very populated. I did not think India offered the opportunities which one deserves. So I was looking at going to West, and we keep on hearing or seeing in the movies, the Bollywoods and Hollywoods, the rag to riches story. So I thought I'm going to go to USA. And I used to tell all my girlfriends I'm going to go to USA. And they are very polite, they would appreciate, laugh about it. But unfortunately, when I got my results, it was not good enough to go to get a visa to USA. Because as I said, I was more in canteen than in classroom, and I was never serious about studies. And without good I-20, you couldn't get to USA. And it was then my bragging or trying to impress the girl came back to me, and the girl started teasing me and asking me, "Are Deepak, you're still here? You have not gone back to, you're not going to USA? You wanted to go to USA?" And I said, "I have to get out of India, even if I have to go to Bangladesh or Pakistan, but I have to get out, otherwise these girls are not going to leave me." And so I was thinking of going somewhere else. And while I was working as a chemist, because as I said, my father did not want me to join his business without having experience. And the amount of money I got as a salary was less than the pocket money I used to get. Then I realized that just having a degree is not sufficient. You have to specialize. And I was also given the job because I was the son of a rich man and my father could have influenced and helped them. So I was not known for me or for my work or for my talent, but more because of my father's son. So one day, someone had come from Germany to our factory, and I was like telling him about me, and he said, "Why don't you come to Germany?" And I said, "Why Germany?" Because everyone goes to USA, London, at that time Australia, New Zealand was not in, and maybe maximum Canada, because they were all English-speaking countries. And every Gujarati would have some relatives there, so you always want to go somewhere where your life is easier, someone to take care of you, because I was born and brought up in a joint family. And in joint family, the boys are the pashas, you know, like everything is done for them. So I was like a softie. I was not really grilled and prepared for the real life. And because I was rich, my parents had all those facilities for me. When I went to school, I went by car and we had servants. So I had never learned anything to do myself. So I said, "Why Germany?" And he said, "Germany because education is free in Germany. And second thing, that there is no visa required for Indian." This was in 1978. And I said, "Okay, there is no visa required, then at least I can go for sure. I will not go wrong again, you know. So if I tell someone I'm going to go. And education is free, so I don't have to go and take money from my father. Because my father would have asked me, why do you want to go? And if you cannot study in India, how can you ever study in Germany?" So I decided to go to Germany. And I always say it was only after going to Germany I became a man. Well, I was 23 when I went to Germany. And I think till then I was a boy. I was the son of my father, my mother, my grandfather, grandmother. Everything I would do, I would seek for their approval, take their permission, do everything to make them happy. But when I went to Germany, I realized that there was no one to help me, no one to guide me. You have to decide for yourself whatever you want to do. And you take decisions. It may be right, it may be wrong. If you are right, you are lucky. And if you are wrong, you have to bear the consequences. So you only have yourself to blame. Otherwise, in India, we have every time someone else to blame. Here we knew that everything what you do will have action and reaction. And another good thing that happened when I went to Germany was, while I was in India, as I said, I was a student because I was distracted. And I think more than that, I think I was not a good student because the Indian education system forced you to learn things by heart. And I was not good at it. But in Germany, suddenly when we went for exams, we were allowed to take our books. We were allowed to take our scientific calculators. There were no computers at that time. And I was surprised. I said, if you are going to allow me to take books and scientific calculator, why do I have to give exams? Because there's no point. I don't see any point in it. And my professor explained to me that, Deepak, when we teach you, the engineering is thing about analytical thinking. It's not about your memory test. We want you to understand a subject. In real life also, after you're engineer, when you have problems, you can refer your problems to your colleagues, to some books, to some other people, experts. But it is you who have to take decision. And if you have not studied, if you have not understood, all that is not going to help. And I started enjoying that given the freedom not to wanting to learn things by heart, but understand. It was a challenge always. It was like a quiz. You know, they give you a question and you find answers and you prepare for it. And so I became a good student. So suddenly I started believing in myself. Initially, I always thought you have to be brilliant, you have to be genius. And I said, yes, it's not about that. It's about enjoying what you do. So I became a good student. More than that, what happened was that my inferiority complex or thinking that West is the best went away. Because going there, I suddenly realized that we Indians are no inferior, if not superior than the Westerns. Because we have a very strong support system, we have hunger, and we have the basic brilliance, which I think is not a problem. I think we Indians do not sometimes excel in India because we don't get opportunity, we do not get proper grounding. So I started believing that in myself and that we Indians are as good as any of my German friends who were studying with me. And I also became an idealist. Means while I was here, I thought West is the best. Going to Germany, I was challenged. I was asked about India. I did not know much about my country. I gave answers, but I knew that they were just like to buy time. I gave some answers without even knowing the real answer. But then when going home, I realized that I need to know more about my country, my culture, because they would ask some simple questions. If there is so much hunger on the roads, there are cow, and then you are hungry, so why don't you just slaughter a cow and eat? And first, my reaction was, because my mother would say, a cow is religious, or it's like mother to you. And then I would ask, why is she mother to me? Why can't I eat? You ask yourself, and then you couldn't find answers. So I started getting to know, meet about India, and then I realized that a lot of things we did, there were a lot of scientific explanations. They were never explained to us, and what we ever did was more out of rituals. We did because we were told this is not right, this is right. You have to do kite flying, you have to go in the terrace, and you have to eat laddus, and you have to do firecrackers. So we did what others were doing. But when now being asked, suddenly I started realizing that we were like forced to go to terrace in summer because from 14 January the sun goes north, and because of that you could get a heat stroke. So you want to acclimatize, you put color on your bodies in Holi, so that will force you to wash, and your pores will open up, then you can sweat better. Or in crackers, it is because after farming. So I started relishing and realizing that we had a great culture, great civilization, and a proud history. So I became an Indian, and I wanted to help India. So this has been my background. I started as a mischievous boy, not studious in studies, and like grew in from boy to man, going out of India, becoming an Indian after going to Germany, and started loving India and understanding India more after I left my country than I was in country.
Sir, आपने कहा कि when आप इंडिया में थे तब you were a boy, एक well-to-do family से उठ करके then एक दूसरी country में जाना, वहाँ खुद को stable करना, survive करना, तो sir वो कितना मुश्किल रहा या कौन से आपके ऐसे lessons थे जो आपको मिले जो हमारे लिए काम आ सके?
Very interesting question. I think sometimes we do not understand and realize how lucky we are. For example, I remember when I was young and my mother would ask me, khana khaya? And I would say, don't treat me like a child, I'm not trying, I'm grown up, I can take care of myself. It was only after when I went to Germany, suddenly I would miss my parents, I would miss my mother asking me, koi puchne wala tha, khaya ke nahi, ye kiya ke nahi, kapde do. And then you realize how lucky you were, and at that time you were not appreciative of what you were getting. So I understood the value of love, friendship, warmth, concern, worry. Here at that time it was more like necking, you are just like harassing me, don't leave me alone, I want my space. And when you go out, do you realize that all things that were around you were done for your good? We did not value it. It was very difficult. I mean, when I left India, I did not even know how to cook. I never done anything in my life, and I had to learn to cook, and I was a vegetarian. So I did not want to eat meat, so I had to learn cooking. And I realized that we men are inequipped, you know, we don't know how to cook. So I had to go out shopping, I had to learn cooking. And that gave me a lot of insight into real life. I started understanding the value of work, value of planning, value of cleanliness, hygiene, so that I find my things, preparing ahead of time. So I think this is the great learning for me. More than education, what I got was the overall development which happened. I had to go and finance my studies because I saw that there were a lot of Indians who had come to Germany and they were from poor families and they were working on weekends and making money. And so I said, why shouldn't I not do it? Why should I be more privileged than them? So I told my father, I don't want your money, I will also work like them. And I started going out and working, and initially you don't have any skills. So I ended up in working in hotel as a waiter or cleaning utensils. And then I realized that I'm not good at it because I was not physically strong, not good at it. So I realized that I could become a magician. And I financed my studies, became a magician. So you become a survivor. You learn all the tricks to sort of make an easy thing out of difficult situations. So I think that's also very important, that going out, means I'm sure it's the same with you when you go to a hostel. So it's not much different. Perhaps here you are lucky that you can get equivalent good food and you have friends and you speak same language and you are not as lonely because you are in the same culture. But moving away from family has its advantage. And more advantage is that for the first time in your life, you will realize how lucky you were to have the parents who were worried about you.
सर जर्मनी में ऐसी कौन सी चीज़ें हुई जो आपको वहाँ पे इंडियन बनाई, जैसे आपने कहा कि जब आप इंडिया में थे देन यू वर मोर ऑफ अ वेस्टर्न, आप जर्मनी में जाके इंडियन हुए, सो कौन कौन सी वैसी चीज़ें थी जो आपको मोर इंडिया से कनेक्ट की?
आई थिंक द प्रोसेस स्टार्टेड व्हेन आई हैड टू लाइक डिसाइड आई वांट टू गो टू जर्मनी एंड आई थॉट I'm going to go there, and then means my father immediately said, oh, Germany jana hai, koi baat nahi hai. I have a friend who is in Germany, he has a restaurant. So you can work there and you can finance your studies, you can sleep in the restaurant, like we see in South Indian restaurant, people come from South India and their daytime they work and in hotel they sleep in the night. And I was open to it because it was adventure, it was fun, it was to be on your own. And then just before I was to fly, my father called me and says, Deepak, you cannot go because the person who had promised you the job and you can stay in the hotel with him, he has sold his hotel and come back. And I said, no way, I've got to go. If I don't go this time, then my friends will kill me with their nagging. So I decided to go. And going there, suddenly I saw this, what I hated in India, the crowd, the dirt, the smell, the noise. I started missing them. Germany I found to be too sterile. It was too monotonous. In India, we had so much diversity. We have so much fun. When you are sitting in the train, the guy next to you asks, are you married? If not, why not? I have someone. You know, we are all storytellers. We connect. And in Germany, you go in the train, they are all like robots. They are very polite. They will get into the train, say good morning to you, and then read a newspaper, and you also look at them, or you stare or look through them. Whereas in India, you would start talking. They will start studying food and all. So suddenly, I realize that I would prefer to be an Indian than a foreigner, because when being an Indian, you were more human. You were recognized, spoken to and all. Second thing, what I realized was my friends who were studying with me in Germany, they did not love their parents. They were more for their rights than for duties. Like in India, we are always told that you are a part of the family. So whatever you do, humara apna naam rakhna, you know, mera naam roshan karna, or we are like counting on you, you are our dream. In Germany, my friend said, I'm going to file a case on my father. I said, how can you file a case on your father? And he said, he's not giving me enough pocket money. I said, no, he has made you 18 years. Now it is your duty to finance yourself. And he says, no, why did he give me birth? And suddenly I realized that it's a different culture. Whereas in our culture, there's respect for elders. अनजान लोगों को अंकल आंटी या मामा मामी क्या नाम गुजरात में उसको या मासा मासी. सो आई रियलाइज दैट दिस बॉन्डिंग वॉज मिसिंग इन दैट वेस्टर्न कल्चर. देवर परेस मोर प्रॉस्परस, देवर मोर रिच, दे हैड बिगर रोड्स, बिगर कार्स, बेटर हाउसेज, बट देवर इफ नॉट मोर लोनली देन आई वॉज. दो देवर इन द ओन कंट्री मीन्स देर वॉज अ डिस्कनेक्ट बिटवीन द फादर एंड द सन, द हस्बैंड एंड वाइफ. दे एवरी वन लिव फॉर देम सेल्फ, वेर एज यू डोंट लिव फॉर अवर सेल्फ, वी लिव फॉर others, our family, our friends. I think for us, our friends are perhaps sometimes more important than our own family. So these are some small things which started making me think and appreciative of what we had. And then suddenly realizing that I'm as good as them, that I'm able to survive. And it's like they were in their own country, but I had to work in the country and still make a living, and I was still able to correlate. They started respecting me. I was the first Indian student to be ever elected by Germans to represent them. And my like professor said, Deepak, how come they voted you? I said, they voted because I was good. Because they knew that I will not just think about me, but I will think about them. So I think that inherent imbibed culture, values what I had came out, given an opportunity and time. And I think that's when I started becoming an Indian.
Sir, jab aap Germany se wapas aaye India mein, तब फिर आपने क्या सोचा कि अब जब मैं वापस इंडिया में आ चुका हूँ, मुझे विलेज में जाना है, मुझे गांव में जाना है, वहाँ पे सोलर कुकर और भी बहुत सारे जितनी भी छोटी छोटी चीज़ों से मुझे शुरुआत करनी है, तो सर ये सारी चीज़ें कैसे हुई? आप जर्मनी में गए, आपने वहाँ पे अपनी पढ़ाई कंप्लीट की, देन यू केम बैक टू इंडिया, देन हाउ इट स्टार्टेड अगेन इन इंडिया?
या बेसिकली व्हेन आई वाज इन जर्मनी आई वाज वेरी हैप्पी. इट्स फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम लाइक I was confident, I was happy that the way that things were moving, I was in control of things, I was respected, loved. You know, so that's what the things like SESI were going for you. I was becoming a good student. My parents were very proud of me. For the first time, like my father said, why don't you come back now? I believe in you and all. But I still wanted to do something. I wanted to do something for my country. I'd become an idealist. I wanted to do something for my country. And luckily, I fell in love with a girl in Germany. I met my wife there. She was a Malaysian of Indian origin. And she also, like me, had gone through that personal battles and also become an idealist and wanted to do something for the country, for the world. And so we had the same bond, and we decided to do something which will help our country. And while we were studying, we always believed that we can help our country by doing high technology. Because we in India think that India is not making progress because the Western countries or economies keep the good technology for themselves and give us the trash. So I did my process in environmental engineering, then I did my master's in energy conservation, energy management in a course which was offered by MIT. So it was like really high tech. My wife did a PhD in genetic engineering. And because of our education, we got a job. I was working for one of the world's biggest chemical company, and my wife was working in United Nations as a consultant, advisor. And we would have continued, but for a coincidental meeting with Rajiv Gandhi. There was a conference in Holland for NRI, that was non-resident Indian. And we were curious, and we had heard a lot about Rajiv Gandhi, who was the man in waiting, the prime minister in waiting and all. And he was to come to Holland, so we went there. And when you are successful, you think you have the right to tell people what is to be done. So we went and met Rajiv Gandhi, and in such conferences, there are a few people, so you have access to such people, talk to them. And then we went and told our story and said, you know what, India needs to do this and that and all. And Rajiv Gandhi said, you know what, it is very easy for you to say, do this and do that. But we cannot do because all the good people like you all are going away. It's like 70% of our people from IIT are going out of our country. So there is something like brain drain. The country invests into people with money, infrastructure, hopes. And then they serve the other countries. So why don't you come back? If you really want to help India, then you can only help when you come to India, not sitting here. And you can well imagine that's the biggest ego massage a young couple can get when your would-be prime minister is asking you to come back. So we decided to come back to our country. And this time, instead of going and telling the girls, we went and told our German colleagues, you know what, we are going to India, our prime minister has invited us, and India is going to become a superpower. You'll not be able to exploit us. All those things what you tell, you know, when you want to sort of give back and want to take your revenge, you know, for all the good or bad experiences. And Unfortunately or fortunately, when we came back, there was no Rajiv Gandhi, there was no one to receive us. So the decision to came more out of ego massage and more out of perhaps wanting to do something for India and thinking that our Prime Minister is making us an opportunity. We thought we were going to be the Sam Pitroda of India because Sam Pitroda had been able to revolutionize India by bringing telephone technology or information technology to India. Unfortunately, in our case, it was not the case. There was no one. But again, as they say, an Indian can lose everything but his face. So we couldn't go back because if we had gone back, the Germans would have said, oh, so you came back, you wanted to compete us and you wanted your Prime Minister is going to do things for you. So we said, no, we will not go back because we will lose our face. So we decided to stay back in our country. And since I had nothing to do, so I decided I'm not going to join my father's business, but I will work for a German company for Southeast Asia. So I started selling heat recovery systems in Southeast Asia. And my wife, who was a foreigner, started staying back home. She went to university saying that she's a PhD in genetic engineering and she could teach at the university. But she was a foreigner. She did not have a work permit. I think the management and the professors that time saw her as a competitor because she was a woman, foreigner, educated in Germany. So somehow she did not get the job she wanted. And she was provoked by people because every time she met people said, oh, we have come back to India to help India. And like someone said, you know, madam, we don't require a foreigner to come and help our country. We are all brilliant, good enough. Only thing what we don't have is money. We have no problems. And no, only problems are people like you, the NRIs, because at that time the NRI was not required Indian. And she was provoked, so she started saying, how can there be no problem? There are always problems. So being a PhD and analytical person, she started collecting from newspapers all the problem areas, and she identified like 26 areas, from child marriage to sati, pratha, and other things, and drugs and everything. But the problem which was most occurring at that time was drought. For 3 years it had not rained in Baroda, where we had settled. And then she looked around and said, why is the problem? And she analyzed that there was a problem because there was deforestation. There was a problem because there was misuse of resources. Like our neighbors would water their garden in the morning, evening, wash their car every day. They would take bath 2 times a day. And there was so much water wastage. And she could not realize, how can we waste so much water just because we have it, and then few kilometers away there are people that the servant would have to carry water like 5 kilometers carrying from her house to her slums where there was no water access. So she started telling people not to waste water and started creating awareness. And she was shocked when the neighbor said, Shirin, there's enough water, you just have to go deep enough. And these were architects, educated people. So she realized that what was missing, we could read and write, we were educated, we had degrees, but we did not have this holistic understanding of resource and limited or its limit. So she started preparing posters of saving environment, importance of water, organic farming, poison in food. And I was not so really impressed what she was doing, but I was happy that she was doing something so that I could pursue what I wanted. You know, that is typical men. We men want our peace, and we think that, as they say, ki purush ki safalta mein stri ka aadha hissa hota hai, aur main kehta hu, aur nisfalta mein pura. अगर एक स्त्री चाहे तो आपको बर्बाद भी कर सकती है, बदनाम भी कर सकती है. आई वॉज लक्की दैट शी डिड नॉट डू दैट, बट आई थॉट शी वॉज नॉट डूइंग इट बिकॉज शी वॉज ऑक्यूपाइड एंड शी वॉज नॉट फ्रस्ट्रेटेड एंड शी वॉज बिजी विद समथिंग एंड डिस्ट्रैक्टेड. बट वॉट आई सॉ वॉज दैट इन स्पाइट ऑफ माई ट्रैवलिंग ऑफ द वर्ल्ड, वर्किंग फॉर जर्मन कंपनी, मेकिंग लॉट ऑफ मनी, आई वॉज नॉट वेरी हैप्पी बिकॉज आई वॉज अहेड ऑफ टाइम. आई वॉज सेलिंग हीट रिकवरी सिस्टम विच वॉज नॉट इंडिया, बिकॉज इन इंडिया एट दैट टाइम वी हैड द मोनोपोली. It was a seller's market. You could sell anything. If you wanted an ambassador car, you had to wait for 5 years. If you wanted a phone, you had to wait for 10 years. So there was nothing about quality. We could produce anything of any quality at any price and you could sell. So energy conservation was not a priority. And people would buy it because government had brought a legislation that if you want to go public, you have to have energy conservation, energy audit. So people would get things done from me, but not use it. It was more like a showpiece. So I was very frustrated because I could not understand how a company could not implement energy conservation measures which I had suggested them if there was so good economics. And they said, no, we don't want to do it because we have easier way to make money than do all these complex technologies. And on the other side, my wife, who had all the rights to be frustrated because she was not respected or loved by people for what she did or she said, because she was very adamant, she was very strong-headed, she was very direct, and she would tell people things what they were not accustomed to hearing. So whenever we were invited for a party, my host would say, Deepak, please come for this party today and you bring your wife, but please tell her she should not talk about this environmental thing because we are tired of it. You know, we have enough problems. We want to relax, we want to drink and have a merry evening. So I one day told my wife, how come, why do you want to have this problem? Why do you want to sort of keep on provoking people? It's their life, they can do whatever. We have no right to go and tell person what they have to do. And she said, I will do that because I think it's my duty. And I am doing it because it makes me happy, because at least then I have done what I have to do. It is up to them to do or not to do. And she was very much at peace with herself. So I asked myself, how come a foreigner who is not loved, respected, she is a PhD, so more qualified than me, happy in spite of not getting the acknowledgement, what normally we always say that we all want, we are seeking love, attention, respect. And she was, in spite of all those not getting it, she was happy and I was not very happy. So I asked her once, how come you are happy and how come I am unhappy? And she said, I am happy because I am doing what is right and what gives me fulfillment, and you are unhappy because you are trying to prove yourself. And so I decided to join her because in the end we all want to be happy. And she started an NGO called Eco Center ICNIR, which was International Center for Networking, Ecology, Education and Reintegration. And in through this NGO, she was going to villages and talking about stopping deforestation, the importance of trees. And that's how I got involved with her and got into solar.
Sir, ab jab aap itna aage apna kaam badha chuke hain, to sir, ab aap isko future ke perspective se kaise dekhte hain ki bhavishya mein bacche isme kya role play kar sakte hain, ya unke liye koi message, ya ye kis tarah ki se cheeze aage badh sakti hain?
Yeah, it's interesting because I think I suffered a lot because as a child I was given a freedom, lot of money. I was not told what to do, what not to do. It's like they left me and let me explore my life. So I was lucky in that sense, but also unlucky in that sense that I did not, as I said, realize that life is not about you. Life is about us. That you have to live in harmony, not just in your family, but with the surrounding, your nature, the floras and faunas. And while in Germany, we realized one thing was that in spite of having everything, they went green. Initially, I could not understand why would a country who has everything work on conservation and solar energy and all. But then coming back and getting into solar, working in the field of solar, I realized that whatever we do has effect on everything. Not only your family, but on the environment, on the nature and the future of the generation. And they say that Earth is a gift given by the parents to us for our future generation. So we have to think about them. So my message to the children is, you are a lucky generation. You have more than what we ever got in our life at your age. But at present, unfortunately, you are very unfocused because you are more techno-driven. For you, technology is everything, whether it is phone, whether it is mobile, whether it is WhatsApp, Facebook, social media, electronic games. You do not have any physical activity. And I see around me children at very young age having spectacles, having a lot of sicknesses because they have not worked on physical side. I think that needs to change. More than that, I think they need to understand that whatever they will do is going to sort of create a future for them. So don't just concentrate on getting good marks, because most of the time, all parents want their children to be the toppers. I think more than education, what is required is a holistic development. What is required is perhaps the ability to deal with friends, colleagues, teamwork. I think this is the value system which is unfortunately lost to the new generation. Like I was sitting one day and my neighbor was scolding the son, that the son was beaten up in the school, and the mother said, why did you? You're not a girl. You don't have bangles in your hand. You should have gone and hit back. And I was aghast. I said, this is the sanskar, or this is the education we are giving to our children, to be violent. Like people say, achhai ka jamana nahi raha. There is not enough place for good people. So be rough, be tough, fight for yourself. I think no. My message to parents, please do not spoil your children. Because maybe it will give them a lead against others, but it's going to be a very temporary lead, but it's going to come and hit back to you, because these are the sanskars which will not make him bind to you, not respect you afterwards, because in the end we all see the truth. And world has become a global village. Now you are no more a community like Gujarati, or no more a caste, or no more Indian. world is a global village. Look beyond India. And you are lucky, but you are also very unlucky. We, the old generation, have consumed a lot of resources. And you are already having the side effect of that, the global warming, the climate change. So these are the challenges you will have to face. But there is something what is called SWOT. That is strength, weakness, opportunity, threat. So whatever is a threat is also opportunity. These are chances for you to make a career out of it, study it, contribute to work on solutions. So let us end on a positive note, children. You are lucky generation because you have things what we did not have. You are lucky because there are opportunities for you. And you are lucky because you have challenges. And we all need to be challenged because only then do we realize our potential in us.
Thank you so much, sir. आपने इतने अपने एक्सपीरियंसेस हमारे साथ शेयर किए, हमें बहुत कुछ सीखने को मिला और हम भी आगे प्रयास करेंगे एज अ यंग जनरेशन कि हम भी अपने देश के लिए, विलेज के लिए कुछ कर सकें. सो थैंक यू सो मच, सर.
थैंक यू वेरी मच. जय श्री कृष्ण.